So there's always going to be people who believe in classical design. There are always people who will need organizations, belongingness. They'll need design thinking. But computational design will continue to move at a rate that we all are having difficulty comprehending because it's powered by Moore's law thinking. Moore's law being the doubling of transistors every year to year and a half. So things are getting twice as good every year to year and a half, which is not normal.
So, John, what is your definition of design?
Well, I've been at this sort of borderline between art and science for a while, like design and engineering for a while, since the 80s, actually. So each year, my definition of design has evolved. But now I have a pretty simple definition, which depends upon your context. The Design and Tech Reports are things I launched at South by Southwest with a little team at Kleiner Perkins. And each year, we're now in the fourth year, we work to define design in the framing of the tech industry. And there's basically three kinds of design competing for attention. And that's kind of the problem. You have one kind of design I call classical design. Classical design is that old school style of design, designing with your hands and your mind and Johnny Ive, insert Bauhaus, male authority of design goodness. It really dominates the education field. And then there is design thinking, which is something that has captured the attention of large corporations. It's more of a management consulting technique to unlock innovation in a stuck organization to reconnect with the consumer, because the larger the company gets, the further away it gets from real customers. And the third kind is computational design, which is design that I was fortunate to be early involved with when I was at MIT at the Media Lab, bringing together people who were good at engineering and good at design and just making stuff that no one really understood, but now is very commonplace. Things that change on the screen, things that fly around, things that morph, things that adapt. This is a new kind of design that uses computational media. This here uses sort of paper, rock, concrete, metal. This here uses the fabric of people, organizations. And this uses the fabric of anything involving computing, sensing, the new things that have emerged on our world stage and are disrupting everything.
And is it a case, I mean, this segmentation is fascinating. Is it a case that one as replaces the other? You see every year design changing. Do the older versions, does classical design become less relevant?
No, they're all existing right now concurrently. The problem when you say design is it gets very confusing to people. It's because these three definitions are still here. One isn't replacing the other. It's just they're all different flavors of design. I like to say that the word design is poorly designed because it's so darn confusing. That's it. It's like duct tape. Do you know duct tape? I'm not sure in Europe if you have duct tape.
No, we have duct tape.
Duct tape goes everywhere. So design goes everywhere because it's so many things. This kind of design produced a lot of value during the Industrial Revolution. You know, things were being made, manufactured. This kind of design has come into the foreground in our post-manufacturing world, where we're much more services-oriented. We're asking questions about the people involved in the delivery of people-based services. This kind of design is brand new because it's post-industrial, it's post-services, it's basically highly automated type of things. And so you could argue that this will dominate in the end, this will essentially destroy, quote unquote, all these other types of design. But no, I think we humans will resist that change. So there's always going to be people who believe in classical design. There are always people who will need organizations, belongingness. They'll need design thinking. But computational design will continue to move at a rate that we all are having difficulty comprehending because it's powered by Moore's law thinking. Moore's law being the doubling of transistors every year to year and a half. So things are getting twice as good every year to year and a half, which is not normal.
And you mentioned about the kind of the human part of this and the role of individuals. You've been involved in teaching design, and admittedly a confusing term, as you pointed out, at schools and universities. Some might say we're all designers. In fact, we've had speakers at the diff before that say if design is the first signal of human intention, and we, as soon as you change the world to meet your needs, you're involved in the design process. And design tools seem to be becoming more accessible. Is design something that we can all play a role in? I mean, computational design sounds pretty hard compared with classical design, where maybe anyone could start sketching something out and having a go.
I'm not really involved in teaching design. I think that's like a misnomer in a way. I think I stopped teaching these kind of things in the 90s after I realized I had nothing to teach. I was like, whoa, wait a second. The world's changing so fast. I have to get into the real world. So I've like left that type of thinking that I have anything to convey. I've been learning for the last 10 or so years about what civilization is and how creativity and the possibility of making, whether it's making things the old way, making things with organizations, or making things with computation. What I have to come to conclusion around is that this kind of design is holding us back because it doesn't involve computation so much, but consumers are discovering it. Like you described yourself, like maybe Joe, you're not a photographer, but you've got this like thing in your pocket or your bag or whatever, and it's like, that's a good photograph, Joe. And you're like, hey, I'm a photographer. Or like, you know, you're sitting there and you like, you know, press a few buttons and suddenly you've got like a banner, like a web banner or whatever. You know, it's like, whoa, I just made an ad. And so what's happening is that a lot of classical design skill is being emulated by computation, therefore putting in the hands of consumers. And what you'll see is people who are classical designers will say, Joe, you're not a photographer. You're not a designer. Go home. Because that's the way this world operates. It's mm-hmm. a little bit snobby. But in reality, Joe, you're like, hey, this is a good photograph. This is a good ad. I would say feel comfortable knowing that you're leveraging what's happening here. For those people who choose to stay here, I'm totally okay with that. But I caution anyone stuck here because this world is stuck in a world where it believes that men create everything. I'll give an example. You ask any person who loves classical design, name your top 10 favorite designers. They're all going to name generally men. It's because that's the whole doctrine. It's been taught the old way. But Joe, you're like a modern person. You've got your beard, your stylish beard. You know that half the world is women. So how is it possible for an entire field to leave out half the other world? And how can it be actually an amazing field?